In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and what I have failed to do.
On us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Fill our hearts, we pray, with the warmth of your love, so that loving you in all things and above all things, we may attain your promises, which surpass every human desire. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Seven columns. She has dressed her meat, mixed her wine. Yes, she has spread her table. She has set out her maidens. She calls from the heights out over the city. Let whoever is simple turn in here. To the one who lacks understanding, she says, come, eat of my food, and drink of the wine I have mixed. Forsake foolishness that you may live. Advance in the way of understanding. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Please open your gathered hymnals to number 47.
Hallelujah.
and I in him, says the Lord.
Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. The Jews quarreled among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you do not have life within you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me, and I have life because of the Father, so also the one who feeds on me will have life because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Unlike your ancestors who ate and still died, whoever eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
There's a story told about an 85-year-old man who, despite his old age, was quite healthy. And it was largely due to the fact that he always ate healthy food and he exercised regularly for the last few decades of his life. But one day, unfortunately, he was caught in an accident and he died. And so after being purified in purgatory, he was met by St. Peter at the pearly gates and ushered in. And from the very first moment, he began to be amazed how great, how wonderful, beautiful heaven is. St. Peter led him to his mansion, where he would be staying for all eternity. And it was very lavishly decorated, and he just, again, couldn't stop wondering at the beauty of it all. Then as he looked through the window of his mansion, he sees his championship golf course. And it is much more beautiful than any golf course can be created here on earth. And so, being a golfer, instinctively asked, so what are the fees to play it there? And St. Peter says, this is heaven. This is for free. Anytime you want, you can play. So as they walk out, they go to the clubhouse and next to the course. And again, the food on the buffet table is very lavish. All the everything that he can imagine is there, and even more than he can imagine. And as he is looking at all this, St. Peter says, don't even ask. This is all prepared for you because you've been faithful to Christ during your life on earth. But as he's looking at the food, he starts to ask the question, so where is that fat-free meal or the low-cholesterol food? And St. Peter says, this is the best part. You can eat all you want, and you will not be sick or gain weight. The man says, so I don't have to exercise? And St. Peter, no, unless you want to. And at this, the man becomes a little bit sad. And St. Peter asks him, so why are you so sad? You are in heaven. And the man says, well, I just realized, if I would not have eaten those bran muffins for the last 20 years, I would have been here much, much earlier. This man was eating healthy food because he wanted to lead a healthy earthly life. But we are called to lead a healthy heavenly life right now here on earth. And for that, God is offering us nourishment, his body and blood, the bread of life. When we hear about heaven, we usually think about, like in that story, something that is at the end of our life, but or end of our earthly life. But heaven actually begins here on earth. The beginnings of heaven are right now. When we turn to Christ, we accept Him into our hearts and we live His life. And that's where the beginnings of heavenly life are. That is why when we come here to celebrate Mass and we see the Eucharist, yes, Eucharist is given to us so that we can take on the duties that we have to do and to fulfill them faithfully. But also, Eucharist is pointing to heaven, to that heavenly reality. And so every Mass will always and should have this vertical dimension when our minds and hearts are lifted up to God so that we will remember this heavenly orientation. So as we leave from here to go on to live the days of the week, so that we will keep it in mind that yes, the heavenly life begins right now when I'm united to Christ already through baptism and I want to continue to grow in it. And this is so important to always keep this heavenly orientation in whatever we do. And in order to help with that, St. Paul in his letter to Ephesians, I think, he gives us a few pieces of advice how to keep this heavenly orientation. So in the midst of all the duties and the hectic life, we would never forget what is this all about. So first he says, watch carefully how you live. Living a life of faith is never something out of matter, but it will always entail this active decision every day. So we have to decide to use our faith. We have to decide to live by our faith. We have to decide to trust God. It will not come automatically. It has to be exercised in our life. And that's how we get stronger, by using our faith. That's how we build up our faith in life. There's always this temptation at times to think that, well, I have done enough. Perhaps I can kind of rest in my life. But that is a false reality. It's not true. Because in spiritual life, there are only two states. We are either progressing and increasing in our love for God, or we are decreasing, kind of going backwards. And it can be compared to being on a boat and going against the stream of the river. The only way to advance is to keep paddling. And if we stop paddling, we are being carried down the stream. And what is very interesting, that if we sit in that boat and we stop paddling, and if we just look at the water that is touching the boat, there's an impression created that we are standing in one place. But if we look at the banks of the river, that's when we realize how we are carried down. And I believe this is what's happening in spiritual life, that sometimes when we do not reflect enough, it seems like, yeah, I'm just resting, I'm just in this one place, kind of a status quo. But if we would reflect more and examine ourselves more, then we will realize that we are losing of what we have gained because we have stopped having. We have stopped exercising our faith. And that is why it's so important to keep using our faith actively every day. No one becomes a saint by accident. It is only when we truly use our faith. St. Paul continues, make the most of the opportunity. And that's where wisdom is. That whatever God prepares for me today might not be there tomorrow. And maybe it is only today that I have that opportunity to witness or to show my faith or to live by it, or even perhaps accept the cross that has visited me in that moment. So let us not bypass these opportunities that God has given us. They may never, ever return. St. Paul says, do not continue in ignorance, but try to understand the will of the Lord. It is something that when we get comfortable with our faith, often we kind of sort of stop there, as I mentioned earlier, and we don't want to learn more. And I think this is key, that as long as we live, we are told to understand more of why we are Catholics, why we are doing what we are doing. Why are certain actions immoral, and why we are called to do other things, and so on. We cannot just get satisfied with our life as it is right now, like, okay, I have sort of made peace with myself. I have come to this conclusion, that conclusion, and this is how I will live my life. We are to always keep growing, because our conscience is never really a final authority on the matter. It is always Christ, as He is teaching us through His church. So we always have to say, we have to always form our conscience and to say to ourselves, I have to have my conscience formed based on what the church is teaching. And we cannot just kind of set up ourselves, well, I will do this or that, even though it might be against the church's teaching, because that's what I think or feel in my heart, in my conscience. Perhaps we are at that moment, but we have to keep growing up to the point that our conscience matches up with what the church is teaching. And that is what we have to always advance. Not to kind of just support our own ignorance and say, well, I'm satisfied with the things they are. We have to keep looking at the mirror, and that mirror is Jesus Christ. And we should never be satisfied until we resemble Christ the most. And this is why we have to keep going, understanding the will of the Lord. What is His will? Well, first of all, His will is for us not to sin. And so we do have to know what is sin, what is mortal sin, and so on. But also we have to then keep going and realize what is it that God is calling me to do today, perhaps in my life, this overall picture, the vocation, but also daily, that God really wants me to do something today. God is not someone who just created me, you know, sits back and watches me what I'm doing. He's actually giving us guidance. He's instructing us. And we have to look for those teaching moments, because otherwise we will miss the will of the Lord. Do not get drunk on wine, in which lies debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. Here Paul was referring to the widespread abuse of alcohol in the cities of the Roman Empire, but I think he was referring to something much more fundamental. We are all created with the hole in our hearts, and it was on purpose, so that we could receive in our hearts God, so that we would be filled with His presence, with His love, and find our contentment and happiness in Him. But the problem is that sometimes we feel that hole is something other than God. We fill it with worldly things. And what happens is that once it's filled there, filled up with worldly things, worldly thinking, then we cannot really live the life of God. We are kind of hampered, and there's an obstacle. And sometimes we wonder, why am I not advancing in love for God? And it is perhaps that I have filled myself with something other than Christ thinking. I have begun some, or allowed something else to come into my heart. And this is where we have to be very careful. I was told once about a grandmother, a Catholic one, who was always saying that how pro-life she is. But if one talked to her a little bit more, she said, well, but I also would like to have the abortion around because I have a granddaughter, and I would like her to have that option. This woman was filled completely with the worldly thinking, worldly spirit. And she was kind of entrapped in this false reality that she did not see what was happening to her. It's almost like being caught. We sometimes think that, well, that drunk person always thinks that they are the greatest thinkers on earth. But in reality, they cannot think straight. And that's what happens when we allow the spirit of the world to come into our hearts. We sort of live in a false reality, and we can never get out of it. That is why we have to always make sure it is the Holy Spirit that dwells in our hearts, so that the reality will be the true one, the one that was created by God and not distorted by the world. And finally, St. Paul says, give thanks always and for everything. In other words, there is always reason to be thankful to God. There is never reason to be mad at God, because first of all, He gives us the gift of His love that is with us all the time. So there is always a reason to be thankful. He supports us and gave us the best gift, the gift of life. Perhaps this gift of life will be fully appreciated only in heaven, because only then we'll realize what it is to be living forever in the presence of God. But as we are giving thanks, let us not bypass the sufferings. Because those two actually are moments that we should be thankful to God. Jesus said to St. Faustina once that if angels were capable of envy, they would envy two things from us. One is the Eucharist and the other is sufferings. Because through both of these, we can come much closer to God. Angels who are with God in heaven cannot enter into His heart as we are capable through the Eucharist and through the suffering. And so it is in some sense a blessing when God is inviting us by picking up our daily crosses, sometimes very heavy crosses. But through these crosses, our hearts are enlarging. It is through these crosses that we can enter into Christ's heart as He is hanging on the cross. And it's a tremendous blessing. That's when actually our eyes are opening up to God. That's when we actually understand more. Because we are not thinking along the lines of what our senses present to us. But we are really looking at the things through the eyes of faith. And that's when we can understand more. That's when actually we can really unite ourselves to God. And that's when we open up to the many graces that come from the cross. I do believe that in heaven we will never ever regret that we have picked up the cross, that we have stayed faithful to Christ even in the midst of these great difficulties, that we put aside our own selfish desires and we have accepted the reality of faith. Giving thanks is also a name for the Eucharist. That's a Greek word for Eucharist, which means giving thanks. So as we are celebrating the Mass today, as we're celebrating the Eucharist, let us be thankful to God for the gift of the Eucharist that comes our way, as He is nourishing us. But let us also give thanks to the Lord in the Eucharist for nourishing in us this heavenly orientation. And let us ask Him today for this grace to never forget the heavenly reality starts right now. If we live it now, then one day we will fully enjoy it with Him in His kingdom. Amen. Let us now profess our faith. I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, life from life, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father.
Father gives us His own Son as real food and real drink at this altar. We can ask Him for all we need in Christ, the source of our new life.
For our Pope, our bishops, priests, and deacons who minister in the Eucharistic mysteries, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For wisdom and foresight in the sharing of food in regions of need, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For choirs, organs, musicians, and composers who help us to praise God with beauty and joy in prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For more frequent and reverent reception of the body and blood of our Savior, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, especially Herb Hoffman, Jessica Moretti, Mason Tapia, Danielle Bradford, Joey Craig, John Matusik, Dr. Karen Noel, Cal Berman, Jim Trendelson, Julie Lander, Randy Hewitt, Ben Florisi, Eleanor Babbitt, and Glenn Zabel. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Father Gordon Lerner, Pat Love, Jane Ware, and for Norbert Stengel, for whom this mass is being offered, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of earth and altar, reunite our prayers to the intentions of the whole Church, nourished and united by your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Second collection today is for faith and value.
Please open your missalettes to number 330.
Thank you. and lift them up to the Lord. It is right and just.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oh,
last word.
Make partakers of Christ through these sacraments. We humbly implore your mercy, Lord, that conformed to his image on earth, we may merit also to be co-heirs in heaven, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
For may always the bread of life keep strong in us this heavenly orientation of daily life. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thanks be to God. Please open your missalettes to number 337.
Thank you.